The second panel should gather an understanding on unlocking end user finance versus simple livelihoods, wherein the panelists, primarily made up of financials, would discuss their experience in the financing for energy and lighting interventions, and the barriers and opportunities they see in scaling such solutions on their products. To start the set the context, we would like to call upon Mr. Ramsingh, Kabadi, a tailoring entrepreneur from Odisha. He's a very popular tailor in the region. He could not meet the demands of the customers. He resorted to solar energy solution for his enterprise 3 years ago, and his productivity and profits have been increased since then. He's one of the first few entrepreneurs in the region who raised a loan from National Bank in this region. Since then, he's expanded his workshop. We'd like to welcome Ramsingh.
Ramsingh Kabadi, Magga Barchatra, Block Thamul Rampur, District Kalahandi, Odisha. I have worked in Tailor. Agaru 2012 और ये धामुल रामपुर में ट्रेनिंग बाहर लगी ग्लोबल एमरल डायरी पेशन ट्रेनिंग क्लास समय के फॉर्म पकड़ी फॉर्म पकड़ा लाते थे तो अपन समय के 3 मास ट्रेनिंग करी
सो ही इज रामसिंह कबाड़ी फ्रॉम तुआमुल रामपुर ब्लॉक ऑफ कलाहंडी डिस्ट्रिक्ट इन ओडिशा So he was working in a tailor shop nearby. So at that time, a notification came for the training, global fashion trust training program for tailoring. And he opted that and he continued the training for 3 months there.
3 months training sarla. Sarla pare le marpake paisa nahi na. Le anya ro paisa kenta korle bahar ba. Se planning korli mu. To जनकू सुना रे 2 ग्राम मागली सुना 2 ग्राम मागी सरला परे सेटा कने आउ अन्य जनक पाके नहीं करी बंधा पकाई दिली बंधा पकाई दिली 5000 टंका 5000 टंका के नहीं करी जपटना रे जाई करी 4500 टंका दे करी गोटे नुआ मशीन गोटे किणी आनली तापरे अमर काम आरंभ करली
ओके सो आफ्टर ट्रेनिंग ही डिसाइडेड टू बाय अ स्विंग मशीन Then, but he didn't have money to buy this. So, what he thought, he took gold from someone. He asked for some gold. He got it and he mortgaged the gold and for, in a local money lender. Then he got the amount of 4,500. He went to Jaipatna, a nearby market, and he bought a sewing machine from that money.
Training 3 months sarla pare, me jai kari State Bank manager sange kotha aili. तो कथा हला भितरे नै तुमर थामुल रामपुर ब्लॉक रे लोन रो देबा व्यवस्था नै काहे जे कि बहुत लोग लोन नै दै छन तो से लोन टा सुझी परबार नै ते पर्यंत सेति लागि तुमके लोन टिके लेट लागबा बोल करी थामुल रामपुर स्टेट बैंक रो मैनेजर कहिथिले
So before mortgaging gold and taking money from the local money lender, he approached the service area bank SBI. But the SBI manager said there is a lot of NPAs in your area, so we will not give you loan right now. You wait for some time and he has not defined the time when he can get the loan. But we will give you like this, he said, and he returned to home very demotivated.
से मशीन आनीकरी काम स्टार्ट है तापरे 3 वर्ष गला परे 3 वर्ष गला परे तो मुई आमर गाँव जने भाई गोटे कहले जे मके नहीं आउ आमर सेल्को फाउंडेशन बोली गोटे संस्था अच्छे बालसरा सेल्को फाउंडेशन बोली संस्था गोटे अच्छे से संस्था रे समस्त प्रकार ये काम सुविधा जगाई दे कहले তারপরে এ বিষয়ে আমি কেনা করি যাবি সে পাখে সেটা আমি জানি না পাই তো আমার সেলকো ফাউন্ডেসনর আজ্ঞা মানে সে তো তাঁর আড্রেসে সে পলাই আসি মোকে আমার ঘরকে আসি দেখে
সো ডিউরিং দ্য ইন্টারাকশন উইথ রামসিংহ So I came to know that he is like for 3-4 years from 2012 to up to 16, he was running with that manual sewing machine, but that he was not earning much from that. It's average 2000 per month. So whatever he had invested, he was trying hard to get it back. So because the manual sewing machine needs constant movement of the legs and it caused leg pain, knee pain for him. So for he couldn't continue for longer hours a day for that with that work. And night also they didn't have that light in their house. So even if he wanted, he could not even work during night. So that was the problem he was having and he was always searching for the solution. Then in 2016, so during the community interaction of SELCO team in the village, so the villagers came to know about the livelihood interventions of SELCO and they informed the team that there is a potential tailor in the village and the team then approached him about the solar sewing machine.
परे सेल्को सार मन जबकि बोले आ दो दिन चाड़ी करी आसे बोले कर कोई कर गले तापरे मुई सन घर सीधा बालसरा रे गलि बालसरा गला परे सार मन का संगे कथा हैली हो ठीक अछे संगे संगे सोलार ओ बैटरी ओ एटा सुइंग मशीन मोटर एटा लगाई देबा बोली करी सार मन कहले
Yeah, so the team of Baleshwar SELCO Foundation, he said them that after two days we'll come and approach you. So after that he went to Baleshwar and talked to this team that how can he get this solar sewing machine.
তারপরে আউ ভবানীপাটনা ব্যাঙ্করে আকাউন্ট খোলবাকে পড়া বলি করি আমার সেলকো সার মানে কহিল তারপরে দুই দিন ছাড়ি করি ভবানীপাটনা ব্যাঙ্ক সিন্ডিকেট ব্যাঙ্করে আকাউন্ট খুলি দিলি খুলে দেওয়া পরে দুই মাস ভিতরে আমার ইয়ে সেলকো সার মানে আজ্ঞা মানে যে মানে সে মানে ইয়ে লোন করাতে সাহায্য করবে
সো দ্য মেজর প্রবলেম অগেইন আরাইজ দ্যাট ফিনান্স So as he was very demotivated during the previous interaction with the service match, he didn't want to go back to the bank. But SELCO team helped him to open an account in a syndicate bank in Bhavanipatana, which is 80 kilometers from his village. So he traveled with the team and he's opened an account with the help of the team there.
মেশিনের টোটাল কস্ট হচ্ছে 24,000 টাকা সোলার গোটে 60 ওয়াট আউ ব্যাটারি 40 AH আউ ডিসি মোটর হলো 60 ওয়াট তারপরে বল গোটে ফাইবার এই চার পাঁচটা জিনিসকে নিয়ে করি 24,000 টাকা 24,000 টাকা তো 24,000 ভিতরে মুই ডিপোজিট করে দিয়েছিলি 5,000 টাকা মার্জিন মনি 5,000 টাকা ডিপোজিট করা টোটাল লোন হল 19,000 টাকা 19,000 লোন মাসে 715 টাকা ডিপোজিট করবাকে পড়ছে
সো উইথ দ্য হেল্প অফ দ্য টিম হি গট দ্য মেশিন কস্ট 24,000 সো হি আসড 5,000 অ্যান্ড অ্যানাদার 19,000 দ্য টিম হেল্প হিম টু গেট দ্য লোন ফ্রম সিন্ডিকেট ব্যাঙ্ক উইথ দ্য 60 ওয়াট a battery and a so machine from that and he got a light and a machine from that 19,000 with the help of the team from the bank and then he started his business and
loan jitki bele sanction karwa lage arambh kora matre me bank ke matra tin tor jaiche tin tor bhitre ar odhik moke jiba ke nai padina amar selko raiya mane sabu kichi sane rai kor samane sabu kori deuthile আর তিন মাস ভিতরে মোর লোনটা সাকসেস হয়ে গেল
সো ইট টুকস অনলি 3 মান্থস টু গেট দ্য রোল লোন অ্যাপ্রুভড উইথ দ্য হেল্প অফ দ্য টিম হি ডিড নট গো টু দ্য ব্যাঙ্ক এভরি টাইম অ্যান্ড আস্ক ওয়েদার ইট হ্যাজ বিন স্যাংশনড অর নট বিকজ দ্য টিম হেল্পড হিম ইন দ্যাট অ্যান্ড দেন হি গট ইট
তো লোন সেকশন হওয়ার পরে আমার মেশিন ধরি করে সার মানে আসলে আর 2016 জুন 1 তারিখ দিন মোটর লগাই করি এটা মেশিন লগাই দিল সেদিন কাম সে মেশিনে আরম্ভ করলি
So the team only brought him to the machine at his home and he started his work on 1st of
June 2016.
So after that machine he has recovered from his knee pain and with that shoulder run machine he doesn't have to work hard and his income has been increased. Like average he was earning 2000 per month, now he is earning 3 to 6000 per month because of that machine, and he is getting more orders day by day to, and he is also delivering the order in time because of that machine. He was not able to do that in manual machine because of knee pain, and there was no light, and the light, one light has been installed in his home, so now it has been very comfortable for him to work.
Manual machine ra jitki bele kaam dile mane gotte blouse hele ghonte bhitre silei hotila to ebe jitki bele motor lagla sitki bele din dhar nei ota ghonta ki 35 minute bhitre gotte blouse complete hi jachhe bahut bhal laguche ara agu ku bhi ar kichhi gota re korbi bol kor ar chaiche.
So before it was taking 1 to 2 hour to make a blouse, now with the machine, solar machine, it is taking only half an hour for him to complete a blouse.
Tapare se loan 6 mas gola pare 6 mas gola pare aau gote machine dorkar hela jene amar e pico machine. Se pico machine lagi minimum aau iron pico machine iron dorkar hela pare se onka aau jai kari bank manager sang kothaili to sar aru machine dorkar achi bol kohla ke se sar ha kori deba bol kori.
So he was getting more order for Pico. So in that machine was not able to do it. So he thought after repayment of the loan, he thought of buying another multi-purpose sewing machine. So he approached the bank for another loan of 20,000 for buying a multi-purpose sewing machine.
ତାପରେ ଲୋନ୍ କରିଦେଲେ ପୁଣି 20,000 ଟଙ୍କା 20,000 ଲୋନ୍ କରିଦେଲା ପରେ ଆଉ ଗୋଟେ ପିକୋ ମେସିନ୍ ଆଇରନ୍ ଏଇଟା କିଣି ନେଇକରି ଆଉ ଆଉ ଜଣେ ମୋର ସାନ ଭାଇ ଅଛି ମୋର ସାନ ଭାଇ ସାଙ୍ଗେ ଦୁଇ ଜଣ ଆରାମସେ ଦୁଇଟା ମେସିନ୍ରେ କାମ କରିପାରୁଛୁ.
So as he repaid the loan in time and he has set up a rapport with the bank officials and the service bench branch there, so they immediately granted him another loan of 20,000 for buying that multi-purpose machine. Then he bought a iron box and a multi-purpose sewing machine, and he gave it to that his younger brother to start his own business like him.
Jodi kete bele jodi asuvidha suvidha ache bole mane ye machine jodi kharab hei jiba bole sar onke sange sange phone kar dele sange sange asikri banai deu chune eta to bahut bhal lagche.
So whenever it any glitches or anything happens to the machine, he immediately calls to the team, and the SELCO team arrives there and immediately get it repaired. So he is very happy with that service.
Have our second contact setter, Dr. L.H. Manjunath. He's a banker, social entrepreneur, author, and microfinance expert. He's the executive director of Shri Kshetra Dharmasthala Rural Development Project, SKDRDP, and the managing director of Shri Dharmasthala Siri Gramodyog. Dr. Manjunath is on the advisory committee of Pension Fund Regulatory and Development Authority of India, All India Life Insurance Council Mumbai, Karnataka State Unorganized Laborers Social Security Committee, NRLM Advisory Committee, and Ministry of Rural Development of Government of India. Under his leadership and partnership with SELCO India, close to 100,000 solar home lighting systems have been implemented. It's our pleasure to welcome you, Dr. L.H. Manjunath, sir.
SELCO Foundation for giving us the opportunity to talk a bit about financing to livelihoods, and more especially financing to energy-based livelihood activities, green energy-based livelihood activities. SKDIDP, as you may be knowing, is an NGO, non-governmental organization, based out of a place called Dharmasthala, near Mangalore, and it's promoted by a spiritual person, Shri D. Virendra Heggade, a well-known spiritual person of this country. My organization, SKDIDP, the long form of it is Shri Kshetra Dharmasthala Rural Development Project. Was founded in the year 1982 and got scaled up in the since 2001. We are at present working in the state of Karnataka, working with almost 4.2 million poor families in the state of Karnataka. We work through promotion of self-help groups, which is a community organization model for promoting, you know, the poor people into groups called as the self-help groups. We have promoted almost 4,60,000 self-help groups, and they access various products from various different sources, and we facilitate them. Of course, the most important product will be the training and capacity building. That, of course, most of it comes through my organization and also from the line departments of the government, various government departments, from universities and also from well-meaning institutions. The financial support comes from the banks, and we work as an intermediary organization between the bank and the poor people. We take care of the last mile delivery. We work as the business correspondent and banking facilitator to 10 different banks in the state of Karnataka, and we ensure that the banking facilities, including savings, credit and transfer of funds, are performed seamlessly without these poor people going into the bank branch. As you know, if 4.2 million people go to bank branches, it will create a chaos. So instead, we have established 8,500 customer service points in different parts, different villages of Karnataka state. So one day in a week, early in the morning at 7 o'clock, the customer service point opens, representing a bank, and these poor people come there, they deposit the money, take loans, borrow, whatever, all their financial transactions are done at their doorsteps. So this way, we are able to actually create a very, very, very meaningful last mile delivery of financial products from the banking sector to the poor people without any hassle. What is more important is we have actually entered into agreements with the banks for giving loans to these poor people on prefixed terms, including the volume, the interest rate, the terms, I mean the tenure, etc. So that the poor people are able to definitely know that they are going to get so much of loan, so much of credit from the bank, and they can plan it. So the important component of my organizational work is the planning that these poor people do for their future. So every year they sit down and plan for what they are going to do next year. So, and they are sure that they are going to get finance for that, therefore they are going to implement it. So implementable plans are being done by the poor people. At currently, the outstanding loan portfolio of all these poor people with the banks is in the order of 10,000 crores of rupees. Every year, there is an exchange of almost 10,000 crores between the poor and the banks, and vice versa. And more interestingly, the repayment is also, it's one of the current repayment period, repayment, this thing is about 99.2%. So on-time repayment. In fact, we have no NPAs. In fact, we have agreed to the bank that if there are NPAs from the poor people, the organization will chip in and then, pay back those NPAs, non-performing loans. So therefore, the banks are very happy. The poor people also are very happy because they are able to access funds. Of course, there is a cost for all this, and the cost that SKDIDP has fixed is about 5%, and poor people pay that 5% over and above the cost of funds. So currently, we have fixed an interest rate of 15% for the poor people to borrow funds for whatever purpose. It may be house construction, it may be a livelihood, it may be infrastructure, whatever. So he pays 15% for the loan that he borrows. And the quantum of loan also is variable. You know, normally poor people, I mean anybody in our country, if they have to get a loan beyond a certain amount, they have to actually give collaterals. Whereas in case of these groups, collaterals are not required up to rupees 5 lakh per individual, not 5 lakh per group, 5 lakh per individual also. So up to 5 lakh, the people are able to access funds. 5 lakhs of course is only for housing purposes, but even for, you know, livelihood activities, for purchasing an auto rickshaw, up to 3 lakhs, they are able to access funds. So accessibility of finance has become very easy. The repayment has gone up, and in fact, it's almost 100%, whereas in India, the NPA or non-performing assets or non-performing loans of this sector is almost 8%, whereas in case of SKDRP facilitated loans, it's almost 0%. Now coming back to this is a brief of our organization, the work that we do. We also do a lot of credit plus works. We are a charitable institution. Although we generate a lot of surplus, the surplus goes back to the community in terms of, you know, various facilities that we give to the community. Now, looking exclusively from the point of view of SDG 7 and 8, of course, we work on all the parameters of the SDGs, the poverty, eradication of hunger, providing health, education, gender equality, water and sanitation, energy and growth. On all these aspects, SKDRP is very active, and I'm very happy to say I restrict myself to energy and growth using green energy. Yeah, we have been working on green energy, especially alternative energy activities for almost 2 decades now, since 1998, and SELCO has been our partner. I'm very happy to say that, because we are working on, as you can see, for light and fuel requirements, including livelihoods, create awareness among the community about green energy, provide green fuel, clean fuel for cooking, and to avoid deforestation, to improve rural health. We are working on biogas plants. So the biogas slurry is used as a value-added compost. Regular supply of fuel. Environmental pollution is controlled. Of course, we are an answer to the grid. So these are the four major products that we are dealing in. One, of course, is the biogas plants. We have done about 25,000 biogas plants in this. We have facilitated in the state of Karnataka the solar home lighting equipments. The cook stoves, of course, that's only a small part of it. That is pico hydro electric plants. Biogas, we started working on biogas almost 25 years back. We have appointed biogas contractors who construct biogas plants. Of course, as you know, in India, there's a lot of subsidy. Government funding is available for construction of biogas plants. So the loan requirement is much less, it's about 10,000-12,000 rupees. And the subsidy itself is about 15,000-16,000 rupees. So two to three cubic meter biogas plants, if somebody has a household has about 3-4 cows, he can go in for this 2 to 3 cubic meter biogas plant, and he has to invest hardly 15,000 rupees to complete the biogas plant. So we have done about 25,000 biogas plants so far. We have lent about 20 crores of rupees and we have facilitated through the banks 20 crores of rupees for construction of biogas plants. Of course, solar home lighting systems. Well, at one time, way back in 2000, there was a function conducted in Dharmasthala where the Chief Minister of Karnataka came and handed over the completion certificates to almost 1,000 poor people, 1,000 poor families in the state of in Beltangli Taluka. At that time, it was one of the most backward talukas in the state, and at that time it became the a very unique geography in the whole world to have housed 1,000 solar home lighting system in about 80 villages. So the most dense population of the home lighting systems in the smallest geographical area. That was 2000. Well, we have gone much ahead of that later. Now we've done about 1,07,000 solar home lighting system. We have only a single partner, that is SELCO. SELCO Solar is our partner. We have lent about 150 crores for these solar home lighting systems. It in many places, it is the single source of electricity, and in some places, it acts as an alternative to the main grid also when the grid fails. For the last 10 years now, we have been working on solar water heaters also. As the financial capacities of poor people have gone up, they have chosen to purchase solar water heaters also. As you can see, about 9,000 solar water heaters have been purchased by the poor people, and we finance them also. We also, the last 7-8 years since the foundation, SELCO Foundation, came in and started working on livelihoods for using alternative energies, solar energy especially. We started supporting this movement also. As you can see, about 1,500 solar livelihood products is what we have encouraged poor people to deploy. The roti rolling machines, you know, in the North Karnataka, they prepare rotis. So automatic roti rolling machines you might have seen. The sewing machines, the blower machines for, the carpenters, and milking machines for the dairy farms, the Xerox machines. So almost 5 crore is what we have lent so far to this sector. Over the last 5 years, we've also worked on energy efficient cook stoves. Of course, we have partnered Greenway, an Ahmedabad based organization, for purchase and sale of these cook stoves. We have done about 2.5 lakh to 250,000 cook stoves, lending about 35 crore for these products as well. So our intervention is provide choice to the consumer, choice to the customer to access whichever product he chooses to. So we work with him to build his capacity. We show him the product. We take him to different places to see the products, see the use as such, and help them to make a decision. So we arrange a lot of demonstration. We arrange a lot of visits for the poor people to go and see the products themselves and make their choices. So these are some of the products that you've already seen here. This is my organization, SKDRDP at Dharmasthala. Well, I just like to touch upon a couple of challenges in this sector.
One is availability of finance to poor people for installing livelihood products is still very, very difficult. Mainstream banking facilities are still not available for the poor people. So it is better for them to organize themselves into FPOs or into self-help groups and the availability of funds will improve. But that doesn't solve the cost of funds. The cost of funds,
when you go through SEG or an FPO, it will be almost 15%. So I feel there is a need for the government to interfere here and to reduce the cost of funds to maybe 7-8%, because you are actually working to reduce the pressure on the grid and also actually increasing the availability of electricity through an alternative channel, and it's a green energy. So the government should seriously look at cross-subsidizing the cost of funds to the poor people who acquire energy efficient products and alternative energy livelihood products. This is still not done. For a brief while, 20 years back, the government of India had subsidized certain mainstream products like solar home lighting systems the loans for those solar home lighting systems were slightly subsidized. I think over a period of time that has been withdrawn now. But I think a time now has come for the government to seriously think about subsidizing the cost of funds for acquiring energy efficient equipment, especially green energy equipment. Secondly, scaling up is a very big issue. Scaling up requires more and more entrepreneurs to come and produce these commodities, more and more awareness camps to be done, more and more mindset change to happen, and more servicing to be done. In this context, we are working with Solar Foundation, in fact, SELCO Foundation, and I've been suggesting to them that we should produce a stream of barefoot doctors who work solely on water and energy, providing these services of sale and after sale service in villages. This will have an impact on scaling up. Otherwise, if this is not provided, the scaling up will never happen. So for increasing the usage of these products, we need to produce a team of barefoot doctors. We need to increase the number of entrepreneurs.
Well, I think I'll stop at this. If there are more questions on this, I'm very happy to take those. And I thank you for giving me the opportunity.
Thank you, sir. That was a great way to put the context. We will now call upon our four panelists. We have Chingkhei Singh, who is currently the operations head at Self-Employment Voluntary Association, Manipur. As the operations head, he manages the day-to-day operations in agriculture and horticulture, solar and other renewable energy forms, skill development and capacity building, and microfinance departments at SEVA. Welcome, Chingkhei Singh. We would like to call Sasmita Patnaik, a program lead at the Council on Energy, Environment and Water. Sasmita's work at the Council has focused on access to energy for income generation, healthcare and cooking. In her research, she's keen on understanding the nuances of socio-economic context that define access to and use of energy. Sasmita has 7 years of research experience in rural development, sustainability and social entrepreneurship. Welcome, Sasmita.
Now we'd like to call upon Mr. Mohan Gullenavar. He's a cooperative banker working for the past 15 years in the sector. He's currently working as assistant manager at Chigalli Group Sahakari Sangha Niyamita at Chigalli village in Mundugod, Karnataka. His finance for solar power livelihoods and encouraging micro enterprises which are dependent on solar energy. Mohan Gulen, Davidu Banni Verke Mede. Finally, we'd like to call upon Mr. C. Sathish Ballal, who is a retired general manager in Vijaya Bank head office, Bengaluru. As a general manager, he was heading agri and priority sector credit and financial inclusion, retail and MSME credit departments in the bank. He joined in bank in 1982 as an agriculture officer. He worked in the different capacities in the bank at different branches and retail offices and even at the head office. I would like to welcome Sathish sir as well. Finally, as a moderator, we have Mr. Hari Natarajan, who's got a great introduction, but he prefers to have very short, so please welcome. And I'd also like Priyanka to join.
And Shripati to support this panel.
Thanks.
Congratulations. It was wonderful to hear the numbers. I think we need more such organizations to do this. Then we probably don't need to have this event at all. So we've got a really good mix of financial institutions on the dais. And we also had an end user who spoke about the challenges of getting bank financing. And not just him, I think over the last day and a half, we've heard several entrepreneurs, innovators come up with the same set of issues. In fact, I'd like to do a quick poll. How many entrepreneurs / innovators do we have in the room? Yeah. Feel free to raise your hands up so that I can see the number. Okay. How many of you think that you have a product ready for the market and scaling and therefore require bank financing? Oh, the number has gone down. So there are only about 4 or 5 people who think bank financing is necessary. I thought there were more people who complained about it. Okay, more hands are going up. But this is all SELCO. So I especially liked, I think, Mr. Upendra Sahu from Tarani yesterday was very, very blunt in the way, you know, he explained his conversations with banks and the challenges that he was having. So this is the opportunity, I think, to challenge some of the financial institutions that are sitting here on the dais and try and understand their perspective on why money doesn't flow. And see, you know, it looks like we talk in two different languages, the people who want money versus the people who have money to lend. So hopefully, I think we've broken some of those barriers. We've started decoding the language from one to the other, the translation. But hopefully we take one further step. And I think at the end of this session, what we are hoping to do is for each of the institutions, MFIs, banks, as well as cooperative banks, we get at least one clear action item and a commitment tomorrow that, you know, if we all approach them, that financing will flow for whoever the entrepreneur is. So let me first pass the mic on to Sasmita. Sasmita has been a part of a study along with SELCO Foundation to look at what are the impact of some of the livelihood interventions both in terms of economic as well as social impact. And this is in an effort to provide more data-driven evidence to financiers that this is indeed a bankable, viable proposition. So let's quickly hear from Sasmita and then we'll open it out to the panel for a discussion.
Hello, good afternoon everyone. I'm just going to speak about this ongoing project that SELCO Foundation and CEEW are doing together, and just to lend a little more context to the discussion. So the effort here is to try and use evidence, which is data which is already present with SELCO Foundation through the users of its products, to then communicate it to the relevant stakeholders and then design of the targeted interventions. I'm Sasmita and I represent this organization called the Council on Energy, Environment and Water. We are a not-for-profit policy research organization based in New York. Like I said, the idea is to generate evidence, and I will get into the detail of what kind of evidence we are looking at, communicate it to the relevant stakeholders, and then use that to kind of follow through a couple of targeted interventions which will unlock some end user finance. So the targeted stakeholders for this project are the financial institutions, which include commercial banks, regional banks, MFIs and NBFCs. And for the scope of this study, we have focused on two states, Assam and Odisha. We've also spoken to the Reserve Bank of India because the priority sector lending and a lot of financial inclusion activities per se are regulated by RBI. NABARD, which is the development bank, which actually provides a lot of support and subsidy for livelihood interventions. Civil society organizations who have been working on livelihoods in these two states for a very long time, and government ministries and departments, such as the MNRE, Ministry of Human Development. Though there have been many challenges that have been spoken about, I would like to focus on four to kind of scope the study. Higher transaction costs of these small loans, because for commercial banks, often they mention that the loan sizes for them are too small to kind of deal with. Lack of credit or savings history, that's why you see a lot of mudra loans as well, which are actually mandated for first-time entrepreneurs are also not going to first-time entrepreneurs and to people who already have a credit history or savings history. Lack of awareness or familiarity with the technology, since many of these technologies are new and haven't been heard about by a lot of these bankers at the local level. It also becomes a challenge for them to assess these technologies. And then lack of reliable after-sales services to ensure continuity of use, because if the banker has seen some of these products not being repaired or used properly in the past, that affects their perception and therefore they will lend for us. So the type of evidence we are looking at is the data around finances of these enterprises, which includes annual revenue, income, amount of loans taken for both personal and business operations, frequency of cash flows, resource tenure and rate of interest, if there have been any default in such loans, and the estimated value of assets that the enterprises own, and then the risk perceived by the enterprises in the next 5 years, along with the opportunities. Along with this, we're looking at creating a compendium of relevant financing schemes across banks and ministries that intersect with livelihoods and the solar powered appliances we are looking at, and to document the challenges of existing lenders and regulators, because when we are interviewing a lot of these banks, they are also telling us their limitations with respect to lending, and that sometimes doesn't feed into a lot of decision making at the senior level, so we are kind of documenting that. This is just a sample of what we are trying to capture, looking at the years of business, the turnover, the percentage increase and decrease in terms of change, if you see before the intervention and after the intervention, just to draw a comparison, and then average amount of loan availed along with value of assets. I'll just quickly wrap up with some preliminary recommendations. These are still a work in progress, so it's not conclusive, but just a few pointers to kind of help us think through. The demand aggregation through like a cluster approach or group lending options is something that a lot of stakeholders have recommended. Mostly the role of CSOs, entrepreneurs and cooperatives in this will be instrumental to be able to aggregate demand at some level. Credit line or margin money support, interest subvention schemes by relevant ministries to then be distributed through NABARD and existing banks. Explore alternative sources like general credit card, which is the equivalent of Kisan credit card for the non-farm sector. And looking at new entities like small finance banks, if commercial banks are not the right place to reach out for these things. Leverage existing livelihood schemes in other ministries, such as the National Rural Livelihood Mission, looking at Ministry of Textiles and other, and so on and so forth. You can leverage existing schemes. Trainings to improve the awareness of bankers, both at the state level and the national level. And then assure training and after-sales services through partner institutions, because that seems to play a big role in creating that trust around a certain technology. So that, and last but not the least, a combination of loans and grant, because the role of grant money in the sector is still important. I think we need to start thinking around how do we make the best impact through the existing options.
Thanks, Sasmita. That was well within the time limit. Thank you for that. And since we have time, I'm going to push you on one of the main recommendations you made. If you or I go to a bank for a loan, nobody's telling you go back and get 10 other customers so that we can do it in a cluster approach. So why should that be any different in another context? Why can an individual there not approach a bank? So why should we, even as a sector, even recommend that? You know, why should I just don't understand. So I think I would remove that recommendation out of that, although it may be practically the way to move forward. Just from a theoretical point of view, I don't like that, because I would hate to be told you go back and get 10 people.
You had a response, but yeah, Sushmita, you can start and so you can add to that.
It's not like the banks are not saying they won't give loans to the individual, but then they have to follow the criteria, which is either you have a credit history or a collateral or like a savings history, which is something the banks will also ask us for if we are to go for it. So I think this is in lieu of not having that. If you're a first time entrepreneur who doesn't have, maybe it's such an approach would work. But I get your point.
So you had something bad to that.
The cluster approach doesn't work at all. Actually, it's like, you know, square hole and what, round hole and then square. Actually, because the mindset of different people are different, even in the same environment. So cluster approach helps you to disperse, maybe acquire those assets. But what happens thereafter is the big question. So it ends up invariably with an NPA. The money doesn't come back. And it's been tested over and over again in our country. So let's not do cluster approach. Let's do an individual approach, change his or her mindset, and then only then try to help them. So you require an intermediary organization in order to do that. Banks are not equipped to do that. So that's why the monies are not flowing into this sector.
Thank you, sir. That was actually very good to hear. So I'd like now some of the, you know, representatives of the various financial institutions to just reflect on some of the issues that entrepreneurs have raised over the last day or so, the context setting that Manjunath ji and Ramsingh ji have presented, and your own experience of lending for energy. So I just start from the left, Mr. Gullenavar, if you could share some thoughts.
ಮುಂದೆ ತಾನೇ ಇದೆ ಸರ್ಕಾರಿ ಬ್ಯಾಂಕ್ಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಸಾಲ ಕೊಡುವುದು ಕಷ್ಟಕರ ಅಲ್ಲ. ನ್ಯಾಷನಲ್ ಬ್ಯಾಂಕ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ಸಾಲ ಕೊಡುವ ಮ್ಯಾನೇಜರ್ಸ್ ಅವರು ಭಯ ಪಡ್ಬೋದು. ಯಾಕಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಅಸ್ಥಳೀಯ ಇದ್ದಂತಹ ಎಂಪ್ಲಾಯ್ ಸಾಲ ಎಲ್ಲಿಂದೂ ನೀಡುತ್ತೆ. ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಕೋಪರೇಟಿವ್ ಸೆಕ್ಟರ್ನೊಳಗೆ ಹಂಗಲ್ಲ, ಕೋಪರೇಟಿವ್ ಸೆಕ್ಟರ್ನೊಳಗೆ ಅದೇ ಇದ್ದಂತಹ ಎಂಪ್ಲಾಯ್ಸ್ ಇರ್ತಾರೆ. ಆಮೇಲೆ ಜನರು ಅವ್ರ ಜೊತೆಗೆ ಯಾವತ್ತೂ ನೇರ ಸಂಪರ್ಕದಲ್ಲಿರ್ತಾರೆ. ಸಾಲ ಪಡೆಯುವ ಮೇಲೆ ಬರವಣಿಗೆ ಮಾಡುವುದು ಕಷ್ಟಕರ ಅಲ್ಲ. ಮೇಲಿನ ಮೇಲೆ ಅವ್ರು ಮುನಿಗೋಗಿ ಅದು ವಸೂಲಿ ಮಾಡೋಕ್ಕಾಗಿಲ್ಲ.
So he says, being a representative of a cooperative bank, local cooperative bank, he says one of the things he's actually observed is when people come to take loans in cooperative banks, they are not afraid because they are the locals, they are not from somewhere else, and he also sees a very different bonding between the banks and the people who come to take the loans. And he also tells the bankers can actually be connected with the customers all around, and he sees if something doesn't work, the bankers actually can go to the people's house and communicate.
ಮತ್ತೆ ಸಾಲ ವಸೂಲಾತಿ ನಾವು ಹೋಗುವಾಗ ಆಯಾ ಮೆಂಬರ್ನೊಂದಿಗೆ ನಾವು ಹೋಗಬೇಕಾಗಿಲ್ಲ. ನಾವು ಅವರಿಗೆ ನೇರ ಫೋನಿನ ಸಂಪರ್ಕದಲ್ಲಿರೋದ್ರಿಂದ ಕಸ್ಟಮರ್ಗೆ ನಾವು ಸಾಲ ನೀಡಿದ ಯಾವುದೇ ಥರದ ಸಾಲ ನೀಡುವ ಸಮಯದಾಗಿ ಸರ್ಕಾರದ ಒಂದು ಪ್ರತಿ ಸಹಾಯದ ಯೋಜನೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಸಾಲ ನೀಡುತ್ತಿರೋದ್ರಿಂದ ರೈತರು ಸಕಾಲದಲ್ಲಿ ಸಾಲವನ್ನು ಮರುಪಾವತಿ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ನಾನುಗಳೇ ಎಲ್ಲೇ ಒಬ್ಬರು ನಿಂತ್ಕೊಂಡಿರ್ತಾರೆ, ಸಾಲ ತುಂಬಕ್ಕಾಗಲ್ಲ ಯಾಕೆ ನಿಂತಿರ್ತಾರೆ. ಆ ಮನೆಯೊಳಗೆ ಆ ವಾಯ್ದೆಯೊಳಗೆ ಸಾಲ ತುಂಬುವಂಥ ಪರಿಸ್ಥಿತಿಗಳೊಳಗೆ ಆಗ್ತಿರಲ್ಲ, ಮನೆಯೊಳಗೆ ಏನಾದ್ರೂ ಒಂದು ಘಟನೆ ಆದಾಗ ಮಾತ್ರ ನಿಂತಿರ್ತದೆ. ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ನಮ್ಮ ಸರ್ಕಾರಿ ಬ್ಯಾಂಕ್ನವರನ್ನ ಅವಾಗಲೇ ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಇರೋಂಥ ಸಮಸ್ಯೆನ ಹತ್ಕೊಂಡಿರ್ತಾರೆ. ಅದಕ್ಕೊಂದು ಅವ್ರ ಮನೆ ಬಾಗಿಲು ಮಠ ಅವ್ರು ಹೋಗಿ ಅದಕ್ಕೊಂದು ಸಲ್ಯೂಷನ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಆ ಸಾಲ ಸಮೇತಾಗಿ ರಿಕವರಿ ಮಾಡಿಕೊಂಡು ಮುಂದಿನ ಒಂದು ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಆ ಬ್ಯಾಂಕಿನ ಜೊತೆಗೆ ಸರಿಯಾಗಿ ವ್ಯವಹಾರ ಮಾಡಿಕೊಂಡು ಹೋಗ್ಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಅನುಕೂಲ ಮಾಡಿರ್ತಾರೆ.
Says so, as I explained earlier, there's this bonding, the connection between the bankers and the customers, and if it so happens that they cannot repay the loan, then they actually can go there, they understand the problem. If it's a grey situation where they cannot repay the loan, they understand the situation, and if they require further financial support, the bankers can actually even do that and make sure they repay the loan in terms which is kind of comfortable for them as well. And also, as you said, in most of the cases, it just happens that they'll be in touch with the customers over the phone itself. And as you were saying, they have a very high recovery rate as well in India cooperative bank.
Tama sarkari kshetralli sarkara andra raitaranda hutidanta ondu samste agiradanda krishige bekaguvanta ಪ್ರತಿಯೊಂದು ಸಾಲಗಳನ್ನು ಈಗಾಗಲೇ ನಾವು ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೇವೆ. ರೈತ ತನಗೆ ಯಾವ ಥರದ ಬೆಳೆಯನ್ನು ಬರೋದಿರ್ತಾನ, ಜಮೀನಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಬೆಳಿತಾನೆ, ಅದೊಂದು ಪ್ರಾಜೆಕ್ಟಿಗೆ ಅನುಸಾರವಾಗಿ ಅವನು ಕೇಳಿದಷ್ಟು ಸಾಲವನ್ನು ಅವನು ಸುರುಳಿ ಏನಿರ್ತಾನ ಸುರುಳಿಯನ್ನು ತೆಗೆದುಕೊಂಡಿರ್ತದೆ ಸಾಲ ಕೊಡುವಾಗ ಅದರ ಆಧಾರ ಅದನ್ನು ಆಧಾರವಾಗಿ ಇಟ್ಟುಕೊಂಡು ಅವನಿಗೆ ಈಗಾಗಲೇ ನಾವು ಸಾಲವನ್ನು ಕೊಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೇವೆ. ಸರ್ಕಾರಗಳು ಸಹಿತ ಅವರಿಗೆ ಹೆಚ್ಚಿನ ಒತ್ತನ್ನು ನೀಡಿ ಮೇಲಿನ ಮೇಲೆ ಅವನಿಗೆ ಅವನ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಮಾಡೋದು, ಕೃಷಿ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಮಾಡೋದು ಜೊತೆಗೆ ಅವನಿಗೆ ಬಡ್ಡಿ ರಿಯಾಯಿತಿ ಸಮೇತ ಕೊಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. 0% ಬಡ್ಡಿ ವಾಯಿದೆ ಒಳಗಾಗಿ ಅವನು ತುಂಬಿದ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಸಾಲ ಮರುಪಾವತಿ ಆದ್ರೆ ಅವನ ಬಡ್ಡಿ ಇಲ್ಲದೆ ತಾನು ಪಡೆದಂಥ ಅಸಲನ್ನು ಮಾತ್ರ ಅವನು ತುಂಬಿ ಮತ್ತೆ ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ವರ್ಷ ಮತ್ತೆ ತಾನೇ ಸಾಲ ತೆಗೆದುಕೊಂಡು ಅವನನ್ನು ಬ್ಯಾಂಕಿನ ಜೊತೆಗೆ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿ ಮಾತಾಡಿದ್ದಾನೆ. ಅಲ್ಪಾವಧಿ ಸಾಲ ಇರ್ಬೋದು, ಅಡಿಕೆ ಸಾಲ ಇರ್ಬೋದು, ಕೃಷಿಗೆ ಸಂಬಂಧಪಟ್ಟಂತ ತೋಟಗಾರಿಕೆ ಇರ್ಬೋದು, ಪ್ರತಿಯೊಂದು ಆಯಾ ಕ್ಷೇತ್ರದಲ್ಲಿ ಅವನು ಯಾವ ತರ ಬೆಳೆ ಬೆಳಿತಾನ ಅವೆಲ್ಲ ಬೆಳೆಗಳಿಗೂ ನಾವು ಈಗಾಗಲೇ ಸಾಲವನ್ನು ನೀಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೇವೆ. ಸಕಾಲದಲ್ಲಿ ಅದನ್ನ ಮರುಪಾವತಿಯನ್ನು ಮಾಡಿಸ್ಕೊಳ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೇವೆ.
So since a cooperative bank is started by farmers, their main portfolio is in agriculture. And in all depending on what they grow and what's being farmed, so they give loans for all sectors in all aspects of agriculture. And he also says that because it was done in surety as well, they give the loan. And all of the, most of the cases, actually in this case, in all of the cases, this been, the loan has been recovered. And also for all the agricultural equipment and land purchase as well. And all aspects of agricultural loans are covered under their cooperative center, I mean, their banks.
So I was having a conversation before the session started, and I think one of the things that's not come out, it seems to be a very well-performing cooperative bank because the rates of recovery are excellent. You were saying there's almost no default. And the other thing that he said was, tomorrow you come with 25 proposals, I'm willing to finance. You just show me that it works, and I'm willing to finance. So maybe some of the entrepreneurs who are working here in Karnataka should take up his offer and approach him right away. I'm now going to pass it on to Chingkhei, who's been working in Manipur on energy lending. So again, if you can just talk about your experience with respect to lending for energy, especially the livelihoods part of the work that you started recently.
Good afternoon, everyone. Actually, we had started for solar in the year 2012 with a small hotel solar system. Recently, we have started a customized solar system in the group as well as for lighting system. So, we started with Tanatras from the 1 of November 2018. So, it has been only 6 months we have started. And as on for now, we have completed 151 units has been completed. We have already installed this there in Manipur. And for livelihood, we started. For livelihood, we have started 30 units. So actually, why we have not pushed up livelihood? There is a reason for that one, because most of the women, I could say around 80% of the women are in weaving sector. So as a traditional way, the weaving, it has lots of design in that system. So it has to be done manually. So the power loom and swing machines and everything, it cannot be converted into energy. That was the problem for us. But still, we are implementing in tailoring. So 30 units has been, and another livelihood we have just piloted one EXO, which has been, we got 100% result for that one, because recently we have a cyclone in Manipur. During that time, he was the one who had used EXO for 2 days because of the cutoff of light. So then we recently, SELCO has given a demonstration for co-operative. Then we are piloting that one for 3 months. After that, we will see how it works and whether it can be implemented for other. Because for livelihood, again, we have some restriction as an MFI. So, the financial. So, it cannot be again a burden for the customer for us, because the customer which we are supporting has been working with us for the last 4 to 5 years.
So I want to ask you a follow-up question. So typically MFIs are lending for livelihood activities, but I assume a lot of that is towards working capital requirements, whereas now you're looking at lending for assets creation. So in terms of also the terms, we need to be looking at slightly longer tenure, probably lower interest rates and so on. So how are you able to bridge the two, and how are you looking at it as you move forward in the future?
So actually, we have put up some policy and programs for that one, for longer terms. If it exceeds more than 1 lakh, we are making a tenure of 5 years. And the rate of interest, we are charging as much, lowest as much as we can. So because actually, we are working with different funding agencies. So we need to see the cost of funding as a financial institution, because we have to be paid that one. But as for the grant which we have received, we are again trying to minimize the interest rate.
Now I'd like to move on to Mr. Ballal. And sir, I think bulk of the feedback that came from entrepreneurs actually was against their experiences with banks and the challenges that they face. So, just from your perspective, where are we going wrong? Why is there you know, capital not flowing as easily as it should. And I'd like you to reflect on your own experiences, the schemes that exist. What are the opportunities which are low-hanging fruits that we can tap today? And then what do we work towards for increasing the flow of capital?
Thank you. First of all, let me thank you for giving this me this opportunity to associate with the SELCO. Because last 2 days, though my panel was today, I was here yesterday also, I could see many success stories also, which bankers, when we see things, we don't know. So things is happening. So first I thank. And coming to the subject as such, the feedback which you received, maybe mostly from northeastern region to eastern region. One thing I want to tell that overall credit distribution, if you see also, not only for solar based funding, any funding for that matter, there is always that uneven distribution of credit. So we should not go with the feeling that loans are not given by the bank, it's not correct. Banks have been giving loans, but it is always there. I agree that every person who enters the banks may not get the loan also. So we cannot undermine the progress made by public sector banks, particularly in social lending, that I will clear. Even every meeting of NABARD, always they tell that a lot of funds are given in south, but so much funds are not given in the east of south, that is there. So coming to funding for solar sector as such, let me, in one or two lines, I will tell about the Reserve Bank's views also. Now, recently, up to 15 crores, any renewable energy generators, whatever projects are there, up to 15 crores, it is classified as sector lending. And up to 10 lakhs for household solar solutions, it is classified as private sector. But what I see, the livelihood interventions, what you are talking about, what SELCO is trying to do, it is not exactly that. It is a livelihood solution for some income generating activity. So we need not bother about RBI's definition of this renewable energy for this. So it comes exactly under microfinance enterprises of private sector lending as well as agriculture lending, wherever it is covers agriculture purposes. Okay. Now the question is how to improve lending. Now what happens is all these loans, I think maximum loan may be 1 lakh or 2 lakh in most of the cases, maybe 50,000 also. So here the decision taker is branch head. So he should be convinced. How to convince him? That is the point. So what I suggest is, whether it is in northeast or whether it is in south or any places, so not exactly whatever cluster approach she was telling, but we should share the success of these enterprises among the branches. And lead bank is the most suitable platform for that. In the lead bank system, if these things are shared, because the block level bankers committee is branch managers to be there. Instead of going from the head office to down or from the state or national level to down, in the block level, many meetings are conducted and these demonstrations are done. Though there will be some apprehensions or some reservation for the branch managers to finance, subsequently by seeing the success, they will definitely finance these loans. It is not a big issue. And the government of India's Mudra scheme is exactly suiting this. Up to 10 lakhs we can use. We have those 10 lakhs. Up to 5 lakhs, whatever Shishu or Kishore they call it. No, these are all embassy loans. Simply we have given it name as Mudra. Otherwise, these are all the loans which the banks have been giving earlier also. To give emphasis, some stress, the government has called it as a Mudra loan. And if the branch manager is satisfied that he pays with there is income generation and there is benefit from the beneficiary with this investment. I suggested yesterday also during our interaction, a simple economics, because banks, branch managers run on numbers only. Whether it is
whether it will happen in the field or not, for our record, there should be some very, very simple one-page economics-like thing if it is prepared. And based on the actuals from the feedback, if it is given to the committees, and if it is coordinated through NABARD, whatever lead bank means, I mean, NABARD will be there, LDM is there. And we have to take into confidence the regional manager also. If you can go to regional office and tell that all these loans will be, definitely it will happen. That's what I want to do.
Thank you, sir. Sir, just wanted to challenge you a little more on that. So, our own experience has been we've gone to some banks, branches, and the person is extremely proactive. So, we don't even need to do anything, we just give a little bit of a background and the person is willing to work with us. And then, again, you know, it's very person specific. There's the other extreme where the person is just not interested and we know we don't need to pursue that. But there's this whole chunk in the middle. I would say a slightly conservative mindset. Even if we talk about the schemes which exist under which some of this lending can happen, it still takes a long time. I mean, even in the case of Ramsingh, we were talking about, he seemed to think the fact that he got a loan in 3 months was actually a positive. To me, I see that as a significant negative. So if somebody like him needs to wait for 3 months till he or she gets a loan, and even that after an intervention by SELCO, if he walks in on his own, sir, he may not be able to give those numbers in the economics. How do we change that? I mean, I often get this thing of NPAs and so on, but he's repaid it in 6 months or a year and he's gone in for another loan. So how come that behavior, even though it happens time and again, that there's not too much of lack of repayment at that level, but still oftentimes the problem of NPA is thrust at the level where it's probably not impacting the most. I don't know, I've never analyzed a portfolio, sir, but I'd love to understand in a bank's portfolio, what is the breakup in terms of NPA? Each segment of society, what does it contribute to NPA, for example?
What happens is, regarding the NPAs in public sector, what happens is, public sector have got a different issue. Because a person, this is my personal experience, a person borrower, he'll be very, very, what is that, loyal to MFIs or some private organization. But the same borrower may not repay the loans to the public sector. Because of the government, he may think that this loan given by the is backed by government, it need not be repaid. This is a general tendency, it is there. But the things like the one or two branch heads who are not to only doing what you can do is persuasion and through regional office. That is the best thing to do.
I definitely had a few more questions, but I'm also conscious of the time, and I think the audience, all the entrepreneurs will have questions.
Sir, I didn't know.
We need to segregate between the entrepreneurs and livelihoods. Livelihoods is almost small scale, so it's very too small for the bank to actually operate. So it's always better to go through these intermediaries like SDGs, really help them to hasten access of funds. For entrepreneurs, they need to go through the drill, so they need to prepare a proper project report and approach, and there are differences. Now the question at the bank level is the mindset of the people, actually. See, most people in our country are not entrepreneurial. So supposing you buy a cow and it starts yielding milk, then it stops repaying. And there is no reason, I mean, there is no scope for the bank manager to keep on following up with him. So he doesn't follow. Say, for example, you take a duck well loan. The first repayment is asked after 36 months. By the time the person would have forgotten, the manager has forgotten, and the borrower has also forgotten. So you need to have a proper follow-up system which is non-existing in the banking sector, and a mindset which is also non-existing with the customers. So we need to do a lot of education about bank financing with the customer. Then the customer's mindset will change, and the follow-up system in the bank also has to change, a drastic change. Why MFIs are boasting of a 100% recovery? Because they go back to him every week. So, and therefore he pays back. Whereas the banks don't go, and there's only one manager, and perhaps one development officer in the entire bank, dealing with thousands of customers, and he has many other works within the bank, doesn't go. So therefore, a bank manager is always afraid of the customer's mindset. If I give this loan, whether he's going to pay back or not. Am I going to end up with an NPA? Because I'll be blocked, I'll be marked. So he doesn't want to lend, he just wants to play safe. So a great change has to take place at both the levels. If you're a good customer, you need to make that known to the bank. And if you're a good banker, you need to make that known to the customer. So this is not happening today, and that is why there's a very great large last mile gap in our country. And I don't think it's going to be solved in the short duration of next 10 years. It's going to be there like that. So we need institutions like SEGs, active SEGs, FPOs, these are the only solutions at the grassroots, at the rural level. And in the next 10-15, I don't think this scenario will change. Even with the advent of the small finance banks, it's going to remain.
So although I know that's true, it's still, you know, it's very disheartening to hear that from somebody who's doing that work on the ground, that in the next 10-15 years we still not going to see change. So I'd like to throw the floor open for questions. We'll probably take 2-3 questions at a time. Yeah, please. And do introduce yourself briefly and let us know who the question is addressed to.
Hi, I'm Vikas Mehta with the Global Family Fund. We are basically a foundation focused on climate and energy. My question is for Sasmita. Sasmita, you mentioned in your slides that in the recommendations you had, training and awareness raising for the bankers. And just before that slide, you had as to what you were tracking in terms of your income, cash flow, and all of that. So the question I have for you is that how critically do those metrics that you are tracking figure in working with the banker and saying these are what are the metrics to track, and how does that help them improve the decision making or price the loans for these entrepreneurs? Actually, I have a related question as well to that, which is that when you go up the scale of solar, like from solar home systems onto rooftop solar onto even small scale microgrids, what additional metrics should the bankers be aware of to price their loans?
Hi, this is Simran from Vast Research Foundation. I am a former GSS practitioner who has worked a lot on the ground to facilitate loans for end users. I have two questions. One is that banking is a service, right? And in my experience, it's very individual driven, something which has already been pointed by the panel, right? So my question is from an institutional level, looking at the performance of the service, how can we improve the performance, and what are the metrics also that we can develop in there to measure the performance, measure the service quality? If we talk about it, I mean, I often come across cases where people have to pay some amount of bribe or even just, as I already mentioned, 3 to 6 months just to get a small loan, right? It's a cost that which end user end up accumulating. And we often talk about consumer awareness and, you know, NPAs, etc., but nobody talk about, you know, the circumstances and the quality of the loan from application to disbursement, right? What was the quality of loan maybe? That's one. Number two, I'll cover the number two question.
This is Bobby. This may be a suggestion or a requirement, expectation from SELCO Foundation that unless bank is asking for a business plan or a proposal to either a small entrepreneur or a big entrepreneur. But it's so difficult to prepare a proposal to for a bank to convince. Even if for a proposal for an individual also, like a sewing machine, he cannot prepare a proposal for a bank. This is a real challenges for the individuals and for an entrepreneur to prepare a proposal for the bank to approach. So can SELCO Foundation also handholding to the entrepreneur or to the individuals to prepare the business plan to submit to the bank?
Yeah, so you should preface that with a can. You should say SELCO Foundation should.
Sorry.
to respond to your first question, it actually ties into what he was also trying to say earlier, that you build this evidence to kind of demonstrate that there is a business case here, and it's worked in case of, and we are dealing with bigger numbers here, so we're looking at a few, not individual cases, but a group of entrepreneurs who have used a certain technology, and based on that, they have been able to have adequate cash flows, revenue or incomes, and use that as a way to convince a larger set of bankers that this works, and at multiple levels. Sometimes your decision making is also top down in many ways, where you have a like a manager sitting in the regional office or the state head office, and if they favor a certain technology or a certain kind of loan, that also plays into the perceptions of how people at the district level or the very last mile are lending, what kind of technologies they're lending for. So it's basically using this to build a case and say that this is work in such a situation. So there's no reason to not provide loans for all these technologies and etc. I wouldn't know perfectly how these things translate into like a bigger microgrid or lending for like bigger systems, but I feel the transaction cost, definitely the size of the loan plays a role there, I feel, because based on whatever interviews we have conducted, even the priority sector lending, the renewable energy funding in the priority sector lending, if you see, is biased towards these bigger loans. So even if they're supposed to provide loans for renewable energy, it's going towards bigger players of microgrids or biomass gasification plants, and things like that. So I think the cluster approach, I mean, if I try to rephrase it, was to kind of help deal with that situation where you're able to bucket a lot of loans. And it's not to say it's a joint ownership of the asset. The asset ownership can still be individual, but you're kind of pooling in a lot of these loans to showcase. And then that also plays into the application process, the financing, decision making, and like the education around how to go from like requesting a loan to processing the loan.
A clarificatory question on that. Do you happen to know what percentage of priority sector lending is now for renewable energy? I thought it was almost non-existent, but since you mentioned that the larger projects are getting it under priority sector lending.
Yeah, I think, so currently priority sector lending basically identifies few sectors for which you can provide it. So agriculture is one. Similarly, renewable energy has been considered as a priority sector, and banks can provide loans.
Oh, can I understand?
Yeah.
Whether they are is what the question is.
Before answering this question about this,
yes.
See, from 2015 onwards only, they made that separate category. I don't think it means a bigger fund also, because up to 15 crores only is the cap there.
Okay.
Bigger projects, if it is done under 200 crores, it will not come there. But what I once again reiterate that what all those we are talking about, though solar is a part of that, it is MSME. It is for the livelihood intervention we are giving, it is treated as a MSME only, or if it is agriculture, it is agriculture. Then coming to Sir's question, one is about quality of service, how to evaluate it and all. There are systems, RBI also tells that. Beyond, so for example, up to 2 lakh, it should be disposed within 4 weeks or something like that. But hardly it happens. Now, the question is within the bank, without going that side, there are regional managers who visit the branches. If there is definitely delay on the part of the branch manager, definitely one should speak to the regional. Not only the question of one borrower. If he is delaying, then he may be delaying for many of the customers also. Internally also, bank is having some system of monitoring these things. So of course, large number of branches are there. So there is a system. It's not that there is no system of monitoring the disposal of the applications in the bank. One more question.
No, he forgot the second
one. The other one?
No, he forgot the second one. So there was no second question. But sir, you mentioned that it can happen under MSME loan, but unfortunately what happens is the biggest barrier there is collateral. The asset itself is not taken as collateral.
Up to 50,000, up to 10 lakh is the asset. you leave alone 10 lakhs, up to 50,000 or 1 lakh, 2 lakh, there should not be any problem of corruption. Whatever asset created out of the loan, definitely there is a, in most of these cases, there is a tailoring machine or any other thing, that is the asset. Definitely branches should not ask for that. There are many collateralized loans which are
given. Any other questions?
The banks also have a target, so therefore they need to meet the target. So lending has to be done by the bank manager,
right?
Because there is a target.
Yes.
So he has a credit plan.
One more, one more sentence, because sir also told about whatever MFI loans, whatever loans we have given to for this purpose. See, up to we are a partner with the, then we have managed about 4 million loans to SKB, but under BC model. See, we have given to some groups up to 50 members. That group may be having about 5 members. Each person might have taken 1 or 2 lakhs of loan, and he might have used this for livelihood. This one we have not considered separately. So there is a why through SLG or through JLG these things happen. For example, one more thing: if there is very active SLGs, they are taking the loans through that SLG model, but branch managers can identify the PPL among them and they can finance these loans. So SAG is a comfort to the bank. So individual members of SAGs can be financed outside the SAG also for this type of thing.
I definitely had a few more questions, but I'm also conscious of the time, and I think the audience, all the entrepreneurs will have questions.
We need to segregate between the entrepreneurs and livelihoods. Livelihoods is almost small scale, so it's very too small for the bank to actually operate. So it's always better to go through these intermediaries like SEGs, really help them to hasten access of funds. For entrepreneurs, they need to go through the drill, so they need to prepare a proper project report and approach, and there are differences. Now the question at the bank level is the mindset of the people, actually. See, most people in our country are not entrepreneurial. So suppose you buy a cow and it stops yielding milk, then it stops repaying. And there is no reason, I mean, there is no scope for the bank manager to keep on following up with him. So he doesn't follow. Say, for example, you take a duck well loan. The first repayment is asked after 36 months. By the time the person would have forgotten, the manager has forgotten, and the borrower has also forgotten. So you need to have a proper follow-up system which is non-existing in the banking sector, and a mindset which is also non-existing in the customers. So we need to do a lot of education about bank financing with the customer. Then the customer's mindset will change, and the follow-up system in the bank also has to change, a drastic change. Why MFIs are boasting of a 100% recovery? Because they go back to him every week. So, and therefore he pays back. Whereas the banks don't go, and there's only one manager and perhaps one development officer in the entire bank, dealing with thousands of customers, and he has many other works within the bank, doesn't go. So therefore, a bank manager is always afraid of the customer's mindset. If I give this loan, whether he's going to pay back or not. Am I going to end up with an NPA so that I'll be blocked, marked. So he doesn't want to lend, he just wants to play safe. So, a great change has to take place at both the levels. If you're a good customer, you need to make that known to the bank. And if you're a good banker, you need to make that known to the customer. So this is not happening today. And that is why there's a very great large last mile gap in our country. And I don't think it's going to be solved in the short duration of next 10 years. It's going to be there like that. So we need institutions like SAGs, active SAGs, FPOs, these are the only solutions at the grassroots, at the rural level. And in the next 10, 15, I don't think this scenario will change. Even with the advent of the small finance banks, it's going to remain.
So although I know that's true, it's still, it's very disheartening to hear that from somebody who's doing that work on the ground, that in the next 10, 15 years, we're still not going to see change. So I'd like to throw the floor open for questions. We probably take 2-3 questions at a time. Yeah, please. And do introduce yourself briefly and let us know who the question is addressing.
Hi, I'm Vikas Mehta with the Global Family Fund. We are basically a foundation focused on climate and energy. My question is for Sasmita. Sasmita, you mentioned in your slides that in the recommendations you had, training and awareness raising for the bankers. And just before that slide, you had as to what you were tracking in terms of your income, cash flow, and all of that. So the question I have for you is that how critically do those metrics that you're tracking figure in working with the banker and saying these are what are the metrics to track, and how does that help them improve the decision making or price the loans for these entrepreneurs? Actually, I have a related question as well to that, which is that when you go up the scale of solar, like from solar home systems onto rooftop solar onto even small scale microgrids, what additional metrics should the bankers be aware of to price their loans?
Hi, this is Simran from Vasisar Foundation. I am a former NFSS practitioner who has worked a lot on the ground to facilitate loans for end users. I have two questions. One is that banking is a service, right? And in my experience, it's very individual driven, something which has already been pointed by the panel, right? So my question is from an institutional level, looking at the performance of the service, how can we improve the performance, and what are the metrics also that we can develop to measure the performance, measure the service quality? If we talk about it, and I often come across cases where people have to pay some amount of bribe or even others, as I already mentioned, 3 to 6 months just to get a small loan, right? It's a cost that which end user end up accumulating. And we often talk about consumer awareness and, you know, NPAs, etc., but nobody talk about, you know, the circumstances and the quality of the loan from application to disbursement, right? What was the quality of loan really? That's one. Number two, I'll forward the number two question.
This may be a suggestion or a requirement, expectation from SELCO Foundation that unless bank is asking for a business plan or a proposal to either a small entrepreneur or a bigger entrepreneur. But it's so difficult to prepare a proposal to for a bank to convince. Even if for a proposal for an individual also, like a sewing machine, he cannot prepare a proposal for a bank. This is a real challenge for the individuals and for an entrepreneur to prepare a proposal for the bank to approach. So can SELCO Foundation also handholding to the entrepreneur or to the individuals to prepare the business plan to submit to the bank?
Yeah, so you should preface that with a can. You should say SELCO Foundation should.
Sorry.
To respond to your first question, it actually ties into what he was also trying to say earlier, that you build this evidence to kind of demonstrate that there is a business case here and it's worked in case of, and we are dealing with bigger numbers here, so we're looking at a few, not individual cases, but a group of entrepreneurs who have used a certain technology, and based on that they have been able to have adequate cash flows, revenue or incomes, and use that as a way to convince a larger set of bankers that this works, and at multiple levels. Sometimes your decision making is also top down in many ways, where you have a manager sitting in the regional office or the state head office, and if they favor a certain technology or a certain kind of loan, that also plays into the perceptions of how people at the district level or the very last mile are lending, what kind of technologies they're lending for. So it's basically using this to build a case and say that this has worked in such a situation. So there's no reason to not provide loans for all these technologies, etc. I wouldn't know perfectly how these things translate into like a bigger microgrid or lending for like bigger systems, but I feel the transaction cost, definitely the size of the loan plays a role there, I feel, because based on whatever interviews we have conducted, even the priority sector lending, the renewable energy funding in the priority sector lending, if you see, is biased towards these bigger loans. So even if they're supposed to provide loans for renewable energy, it's going towards bigger players of microgrids or biomass gasification plants and things like that. So I think the cluster approach, I mean, if I try to rephrase it, was to kind of help deal with that situation where you're able to bucket a lot of loans. And it's not to say it's a joint ownership of the asset. The asset ownership can still be individual, but you're kind of pooling in a lot of these loans to showcase. And then that also plays into the application process, the financing, decision making, and like the education around how to go from like requesting a loan to processing the loan.
Perfect clarificatory question on that. Do you happen to know what percentage of priority sector lending is now for renewable energy? I thought it was almost non-existent. Since you mentioned that the larger projects are getting it under priority sector lending.
Yeah, I think, so currently priority sector lending basically identifies few sectors for which you can provide this. So agriculture is one. Similarly, renewable energy has been considered as a priority sector and banks can provide loans.
Oh, can I understand?
Yeah.
Whether they are is what the question is.
Before answering this question about this, I think from 2015 onwards only they made that separate category. I don't think it means a bigger fund also, because up to 15 crores only is the cap there. Bigger projects, if it is done under 200 crores, it will not come there. But what I once again reiterate that what all loans we are talking about, though solar is a part of that, it is MSME. It is for the livelihood intervention you are giving, it is treated as a MSME. Yeah, if it is agriculture, it's agriculture. Then come to Sir's question. One is about quality of service, how to evaluate it. And there are systems, RBI also tells that beyond, so for example, up to 2 lakh, it should be disposed within 4 weeks or something like that. But how it happens? Now the question is, within the bank, without going that side, and there are determined who visit the branches. If there is definitely delay on the part of the branch manager, definitely one should speak to the individual. Not only the question of one borrower, if he is delaying, then he may be delaying for many of the customers also. Internally also, bank is having some system of monitoring these things. Of course, large number of branches are there. So there is a system. It's not that there is no system of monitoring the disposal of the applications in the bank. One more question?
No, we
forgot
the second one.
No,
we forgot the second one. So there was no second question. But sir, you mentioned that it can happen under MSME loan. But unfortunately, what happens is the biggest barrier there is collateral. The asset itself is not taken as collateral.
Up to 50,000, up to 10 lakh is the RBI stops. You leave alone 10 lakhs. Up to 50,000 or 1 lakh, 2 lakh, there should not be any problem of collateral. Whatever asset created out of the loan, definitely there is a, in most of these cases, there is a tailoring machine or any other thing that is the asset. Definitely branches should not ask for. There are many collateral
loans which are given. Okay. Any other questions?
The banks also have a target. So therefore, they need to meet the target. So lending has to be done by the bank manager.
Right.
Because there is a target.
Yes.
So he has a credit plan. So you need to meet the
One more sentence, because sir has told about whatever the MFI loans, whatever loans we have given through.
If you choose to go to the bank or a financial institution, it actually captures and it will actually happen. But again, the loan effectively is how do you have SKTADP as the. It's actually more than just an intermediary. I hope people realize it's an intermediary on behalf of the client to the bank, which is what the. Why they have succeeded in
lending? I just want to add, sorry. The thing is, when you lend to a tailoring machine, and when you have lent to a solar-driven tailoring machine, it makes a lot of difference from the point of view of the pricing of the machine. So the loan size also varies. So that is where the apprehension of the manager comes in. So he doesn't accept, he may be lending very easily to a tailoring machine. But it may not be so easily lending to a solar driven tailoring machine. That is where we need to scale it up. We need to take it to a level where those things are easily available in the market for people to see as they see a tailoring machine. They should be able to see the usage of a solar driven tailoring machine. Only then the perception of the manager changes, because he has to give a bigger loan to this part. A tailoring machine may be 5,000, but a solar machine may be 15,000.
Right.
That makes a difference.
And just adding on to your point, like a lot of bankers we spoke to knew very well about solar pumps, because there's been so much talk about it, there's so much policy push around it. But we can't take that individualistic approach and say for every product we start with that it has to be now looked at as a category of livelihood interventions, and then maybe individual targeting in terms of which products we are looking at. I don't know if that would be better for the sector as a whole to identify.
I'll put back the code on your bill. Like how many policy tanks that you would trust? It all on the individual people who run different policy think tanks we would trust, right?
If
paper comes out of an anything that, boss, that's not the thing. I would not even read that paper. If it comes from a certain think tank, yes, I would read it, right? It's individually driven. You can't institutionalize.
I think he had a question, then I'll come to you, sir.
My name is Thomas from the Access to Energy Institute, and I have some experience in East Africa regarding the repayment of loans. A bank will have the perception that a loan which is higher is a higher risk. However, when you speak to the bank, it's better than the one where you have less resilience. And I think publishing data about specific loans, higher loans will have higher repayment rates, lower NPLs and all. And that is something that will convince bankers.
Thank you. Sir, please.
Whether it is possible to grant SELCO or say some that kind of service provider or something can use interface. Why institutional source, by government or something, that this is the brand. So as is Lesser said, that they get on these things may not be necessary. If it is endorsed by say or by say or by any CSR activities, if it is endorsed, then it will be suffice for the loan some extent. I mean that collateral security, all these things may not be necessary. If it is possible.
No, it is not that branding or that. What manager wants, like he has to submit a proposal means just how much he is earning out of this profession, this occupation, along with this investment. That is what banks also want. Whether the SELCO as a supporting, he can endorse his views, but ultimately, what I feel is, as he said also, there should be some kind of document which shows that this is a viable activity, to show that SELCO can help.
So very quickly, sir.
As a manager, I would like to know what is the after-sales service given by this seller to the borrower, to my borrower. And if it is not certain, I wouldn't like to enter into this sector. So we need more SELCOs, especially in the energy sector. There are many fly-by-night operators who sell a product and they disappear. So normally, naturally, manager brands that with SELCO also. Those he supplied, so he gave loans yesterday, and you know, SELCO has come today. So SELCO would be also like yesterday. So that also can come in NPA. So we will not do it. So the investor confidence is not there in green energy products as on this stage. That's why I'm repeatedly telling, we need more entrepreneurs who come out with definite products who are workable with after sales service, which is most important. And SKDIP, we have done hundreds of crores of, you know, this green energy business only with SELCO, because I have a direct contact with Harish, and so I can, if there is a problem, I can ring him up, and the entire SELCO staff know that. So there we get excellent access after sales service. So I'm very happy, you know, that's why I'm ready to lend any amount to this sector. That assurance is not there from among the other service providers. This is the biggest problem for the bank manager.
Thank you. I know I'm keeping everyone from lunch and you all will be hungry, but I just wanted to give each speaker a
30 seconds to give their quick final comment on what they think we need to do next. I'm actually going to start with Ramsingh, and I want to understand from him in his community if he wanted other people to follow in his footsteps. He's done it for his brother, for the larger community. What does he think needs to be done? Just 15 to 20 seconds, 30 seconds max.
যখন জনে চলাতেন দুইটা মেশিন হওয়ার পরে তো জনে দিনকে যদি 500 টাকা যদি ইনকম হচ্ছে দুইজন বসলে 1000 টাকা তো আরামসে সেই হিসাবে আমি এবার কাম করছু আর দুইটা মানে গোটে মানরে চলছে আর গোটে মটরে চলছে সোলারে আর বহুত ভাল চলছে তারপরে তো দুইটা দুই জনকু ট্রেনিং দিয়ে সারিল এবে যে মেশিন রয়েছে ইয়ে সমান ইয়ে মোটরে বি আমার বসে দুই জনকে হলো আউ ফের আউ জন কয়েক বর্তমানে দুই তিন দিন হয়েছে তাকে দিয়ে ট্রেনিং দিয়েছে আর বহুত ভাল ভিতরে সমস্ত ভাবুছন বহুত ভাল ভাবুছন তো আকা আউ কেতে জন কি বি শেখানোর পাই চেষ্টা করবি তো শিখে সারা পরে আউ সরকার সহায়তা করি করি আউ কেতটা মেশিন নেই করবি চলাইবি আর সেলকো ফাউন্ডেশন সংস্থা দিয়ে বহুত ভাল নাকি এমনি করে কালে এটা করে দেওয়া মনে করে বহুত ভাল ওটা রাস্তা করে দেখাই দেবে
So he is saying okay, as he was earning 500, now two machines are there, the earning 1000, so the income of the family has definitely been increased. And the impact in the community is that already two girls, they have trained under him. So now another one person has been enrolled for training. So gradually they have been coming and approaching for training so that that is spreading in the community that they can be self-sustained and they can be self-dependent by running a teller unit by seeing him and earning so much. So he is saying that it has had as a positive impact in the community as many youths are being interested in it. And he is saying that the SELCO Foundation has shown him that road to, he would have never thought of that kind of income and that journey. So he is always in that success of the foundation.
Sir, again very quickly, you mentioned you need many SELCOs. SELCO is already working on that. Just 2 points, if you need many SKDRDPs, may not be the same size, what would we do in the Northeast especially?
Well, SKDAT is ready to work in the Northeast and on a mentoring role. So we can create several more SKDRDPs because we have the facilities and the people are ready. We are ready to work with them.
Thank you, sir. I think we'll follow up with you on that for sure. But aapki zyada nahi bolye ekdam crisp question. वरना सब लोग मुझे मारेंगे क्योंकि खाने से मैं रख रहा
हूँ। सर मेरा एक सवाल है सर डेढ़ सालों को बैठा है तो सर कुछ और लोगों का तो कुछ ना कुछ लोन है गांव में छोटा मोटा जो लोग है उनमें तो जो भी लोन लेगा उसमें एनओसी एक लोगों कितने पैसा अगर दूसरा बैंक में लोन होगा तो कितना पैसा है तो एनओसी लाना पड़ेगा ये बैंक वालों ने कही तो हम लोग को जो मालूम है ये 15 से 25 हजार तक एनओसी का जरूरत नहीं है ऐसे हर तरफ के सब लोगों का 60-70% लोगों का कुछ ना किसका 10,000 लोन है किसका एग्रीकल्चर लोन है ऐसे लोन आता है बैंक के माध्यम से तो जो कस्टमर बैंक को जाएगा वो लाइफ लोन के लिए हो कि होम लाइटिंग के लिए हो तो उनको एनओसी लाना पड़ेगा नहीं सर मैं
ठीक है थैंक यू
नो नाउ द एनओसी सिस्टम इज नॉट देयर सीधी रिपोर्ट्स आर देयर ओके व्हाटएवर लोन्स आर टेकन फ्रॉम कमर्शियल बैंक्स और other than MFIs, it will be reported in this one. And rural and senior volunteer RBI also does that. Banks should not insist for only certificate, but to ensure that double finance is not happened, they can exchange the details. For example, if a person wants a loan, they can send that name to the neighboring banks, not that in the rural places, whatever cooperative societies, and they can on their default, they can sell, and within 15 days, if they don't get any report, they will construe that he doesn't have any other. But it is the responsibility of the branch manager to ensure that he doesn't have any loan with other banks.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Many thanks to all the panelists. As usual, I always feel that we never do justice to the subject, but I think there are still some interesting news that have come. I hope we are able to follow up on that. Especially, I like the idea of incubation for SKDR BP-like models. Sorry for keeping you away from lunch, almost 15 minutes over time, but thank you all.